today's talk, I would be talking about a new module that I have experienced in Python. So I guess all of you have built models in the past, or you guys build models all the time. So the main challenge that we face is like how to share the results. That is like the biggest challenge, because some people like PPTs and they share the results in PPT, they will attach all the results, and you know, and suddenly the stakeholder would say, if I would change this value, what would happen? Can I improve on this particular result or not? So in such cases, what would happen? Can we somehow give the power to our stakeholders rather than, you know, giving the PPTs, giving the reports to them, and you know, and they would check the results themselves in that case. So today, this is what I would be talking about. How can we actually build a maybe user interface and give this thing to our users and the stakeholders, rather than, you know, you would be working on it and, you know, providing the PDF results and maybe providing the PPTs and all. So a little bit about myself. So currently I'm working with GDNA at Aditya Birla Group, where I have worked on like many areas. I started my journey with Hindalco, which is like where we had to identify the reason for the defects in the aluminum rolling sheet. So in aluminum rolling, there are multiple processes and it goes through every process. And in the end, the sheet is sold to the customer and customer would again use it for some other product. And then you have to identify what is the reason, a reason for defects in this particular sheet. So it is, again, you have to map the entire process and everything. So apart from that, I've also worked in pulp and fiber as well. And apart from that, I've also worked in financial service. Prior to that, I have worked with Accenture, where I was working as a marketing analyst. And that is about me. So currently at Aditya Birla, we are actually dealing with around more than 15 businesses. So that could be your, as I said, rolling business. That could be our textile. That could be your pulp and fiber. That could be your Aditya Birla Capital. And that could be your pantaloons or retail. So similarly, there are so many businesses there. Apart from this, our team is actually divided into two parts. One is like where you provide solutions to our current businesses. And the second part is where we also create products. Products like one of the products that we have created is like where we have created a system. So that system would be placed in a plant and the system would identify whether there is a good enough safety in the plant or not. So you guys can think of it. Suppose there is a system which actually detect whether you are wearing the vest or whether you are wearing the helmet or not, because that would be very risky if you're not wearing that. And these sort of system we have deployed in the plants, and after that we create the report, and that report is forwarded to the senior management so that they can see how many violations are there and they can act on it. So these are the sort of products we are building. At the same time, we are also providing solutions to our businesses. So what do we have when we talk about what sort of solutions we are providing? What are the KPIs that we are improving for our businesses? So one could be like customer satisfaction is there. So suppose there is one customer who is visiting the pantaloons store, and maybe the minute he visits the store, you can provide some sort of promotion to that particular customer based on his previous experience. So that improves the customer satisfaction overall. And the second thing could be, we also help our companies in growing the revenues. And one of the business that I was working was a textile business where we are working on raw material price forecasting. So because we need to focus the raw material price so that based on that, we can set our output price, and that is like thigh acrylic fiber that we produce. We can set the price for that. So these are the sort of things that we do at Aditya Birla, at DNA. And now the biggest challenge that we face is we have realized over time that the timeline for the projects are actually, you know, getting shorter and shorter day by day. You know, earlier it used to be for 6 months you would be working on this project. This is what you have to deliver. But nowadays it is like for 2 months you would be working on this project. You would be presenting some of your maybe results. And after maybe 1 or 2 weeks, they would be saying that, can we have some sort of interface around it so that we can actually play with it? Rather than every time we need to, you know, get some results or maybe change some values, we need to ask you again and again. So this is where I have experienced the new model that I would be explaining today, and that is called a Streamlit. And currently what happens? So suppose you have created a model. Okay. So one thing you could do is you can, you know, expose an API, and that API would be called, maybe if there is some other platform on which you are actually pushing your model, then API would be called, you would be entering the input values, and based on that, your output would be generated, right? This is the basic framework in which most of the models work or most of the interfaces work. What is the problem with this? The thing is, suppose if you have to do something maybe in 1 or 2 weeks, then what would you do? In this case, you would need something which can be encoded in your script only, and it can also create one user interface which your stakeholders can use. So this is where this particular module would be a great thing to work on, let's say that. So recently, so one of the things that is happening is like people are not, as we have seen in the computer vision as well, so now we are moving towards better accuracy. That we need, whenever maybe it's an object detection task, then we have to get the better accuracy in that there as well. Rather than, you know, getting new algorithms, we are getting new algorithms, but not at that rate. Or maybe the theoretical papers that we used to get earlier, maybe, you know, 20 years back or maybe 30 years back, that we are not getting nowadays. The reason is because people are building tools around it. So whenever new paper would come out, there would be another guy who would be working on some module so that people can actually use it in real life. Rather than just having a theoretical paper, it doesn't make sense. So recent innovation could be like, so people have, we already have feature tools basically works on genetic algorithm where it identifies the feature, important features in your data set, and those features you can use directly rather than creating your own features, because it takes time creating your own features. And in this case, you would be getting some automated features. You can do feature selection on top of that and get the important features from there and use those features directly before creating new features. And after that, you can create your own features and use those features along with these features. So similarly, we also have this data robot AutoML H2 as well, where you can directly use the models and, you know, get the results. So this is what I'm talking about. Rather than waiting for your whole team, whenever you have to build a user interface, you need data scientists, you need data engineers, you also need visualization experts. So visualization expert would create the user interface, data engineers would do all the connections, data connections. If your data is scattered all over the places, then you need all the connections as well. Then your job will come, or maybe data scientists would come, they will create some model, and those models will be employed for your stakeholders. So what we are trying to do is reducing this time, because this generally takes 3 to 4 weeks. This whole getting a team, you know, creating all the connections and, you know, getting one expert, visualization expert, and then creating models. So not creating models, that would take a lot of time, but in general. So currently this standard deployment is basically has 3-tier structure. So one is, as I explained, that you would be having one data layer. Data layer would be like your basic layer on which you would be getting data, all the connections you will make. And on top of that, you would be having one functional layer. So this functional layer is basically where you would be coding your business logics, or maybe you would be building one model. And based on that, you would be creating results. Those results would be presented in, maybe if you have one user interface, those results would be presented there. So that is what we call presentation layer or business layer. So for that, if you have to do, suppose, so the upper task would be done by maybe the one who is expert in the HTML or maybe in CSS. And the second one, data scientists can do easily that job. And the third one, data layer, again, you would be needing data engineers for that. Again, because you would be having so many databases, so you need connection for that, kahan se flow ho raha hai, kya ho raha hai, and all that. The typical timeline is, for let's say if you have a very basic problem on which you are working, then at least you would be needing maybe 3 to 4 weeks to create a model and test it on your maybe test data set. It works fine, then you would be deploying it. Then you need to get your team, this is the UI person or UX person, he would be building the user interface. Then there would be one person who would be doing the database connections and all. So similarly, this takes around like maybe 7 to 8 weeks in total for a very simple model to be deployed on a server, or maybe to be to create a new website, as simple as that. So what should we do in such cases? So suppose if you have to produce your results and share with your stakeholders maybe in 2 weeks, then what would you do? There are a couple of options. If you are a R user, you would go for R Shiny. Very simple. But R Shiny has, again, I would discuss it later, but R Shiny has other problems that people usually face. So this is what was happening. So in my case, what was the problem? So I built the model, I did everything. So I had built one optimizer. So optimizer first, so suppose you have one vendor from which you are buying the raw material, okay? And again, that vendor would do a contract negotiation with you. So contract negotiation is based on certain maybe list of formulas. So what you have to do, you have to look at the real market data on which maybe as simple as the price was moving at this rate, or maybe price was, this is the price data maybe for last 3 years. And then you have your output price as well, the one you are producing. Your task is to identify a set of formula or set of weights such that I should be getting profit, as simple as that. So you are buying the raw material from your vendor. With him, you need to do one contract negotiation, because contract negotiation is there, then you have to do it for at least 1 year or 2 years. So just the way we do hedging, and in various businesses, they're hedging as well. So this is what people do. When you have to do one contract, you have to do hedging so that you do not lose too much. It's not about just you just want to gain. At the same time, you do not want to lose too much money, because a lot of businesses do lose money in such scenarios. So what we had to do, so this contract negotiation goes on for around like 3 or 4 months. So we needed something for our stakeholders, which they can actually play with it. They can actually, you know, use their own logics and deploy it or use it and get the output from it. Okay, how much profit would I be getting if I use the same historical data? How much profit would I be getting if I increase the discount on this particular formula a little bit? Or maybe if I change the weight for this particular formula in this, rather than keeping it in this range, I change the range to some other range. What would be the optimal value for the weights? So this complete task, I did it in Streamlit. So Streamlit is basically a kind of module that we, just like pandas or maybe matplotlib if you guys have used it. So it is just a module. You load the module, you start putting on conditions, this is how you want your interface. That maybe as simple as that, this is where, this is the icon where I want the input from my user, rather than keeping it as my own. So your user can actually put the input there, and they can actually look at the output values as well at the same time. So I would be giving you a demo as well, what exactly happened, how did we actually did it. So this is simply a simple command where you can actually use import a Streamlit as ST. And at the same time, so how many of you have used Jupyter Notebook? A lot of people, right? So Jupyter Notebook, again, it runs on Jupyter server, right? So similarly, we also, in this case, we have the Streamlit server. So you can actually host the whole website or whole web page on, maybe on EC2, if you want to give it to more users. So they can actually use it. You can create one URL, and that they can actually use that particular URL and do the whatever they want to do. And so one of the beautiful thing about a Streamlit is, so whenever you have a visit, so suppose you have put one icon over there and you have said that, huh, I want to optimize this particular value or maybe this particular formula. So whenever somebody clicks on that particular visit, it would be treated as a variable. So that value would be passed on in your script, and you can use it again and again as many times as you want and create the functions around that particular variable. So that is one of the beautiful things that I have experienced in the Streamlit. The second thing is, as I have also given one example, so suppose this st.sidebar.select box where I am asking which formula would you like to use. So where I am given two types of formula, one is formula A1, the formula A2. Then once the user selects that particular formula, and then I'm asking, what is the range in which you want your weights to be? You can provide the range of weights as well, and your user can select the weight that I want the weights in between maybe 0.5 to 0.9. Then you can optimize your weights in that range only, rather than, you know, keeping the whole range and, you know, searching for the global optima, and, you know, maybe it takes maybe 1 hour or 2 hours. So you can ask your user, this is what I can negotiate with my vendor. So I want to use this particular weight. So that's what I'm doing here. So in the next, you see one list there I'm one dictionary where I'm putting the value of X, and I'm asking my user that provide the value of W1. It will throw error if the user provides the value maybe greater than 1. Or maybe less than 1 or less than 0, so it will throw an error. You can also provide the step function. So you would be having like plus or minus visits where you can, your user can select that I want to increase this particular value. Then user can select that value, and based on that, whatever step size that you would provide, that step size would be added to that particular initial value, whatever initial value you are putting there. So in my case, the initial value that I'm putting here is 0.6. So user would see the initial value, and based on that, he can actually increase or decrease. And one of the interesting thing is, in Streamlit, you don't have to load your data set again and again. So what you can do is, you can just put one, maybe a cache primitive in the start. And what it would do, it would store the data over there only, rather than again loading it. So what will happen in that case, your application would be slow. Because if you have to use, maybe load the data again and again, then it would slow down your entire process. So in this case, you don't have to do that. So it would load the data once, and it would use that data set as long as if you haven't logged out the system. So for that period, it would be there. And second, this is also interesting that it can be used in deep learning as well, where it could use text, image, audio, video, and definitely data frames and interactive plots as well. So this is the comparison that I have done. So because there are lots of libraries there, so one is the Python, there are Python-based libraries, and there is R-based library as well. So the first thing is, we have the bouquet in Python, we have the dash, we have panel in Python. Dash is available in both Python and R. Then we have the RShiny, which is, I guess, widely used whenever we have to create one app or something. Then the people go for RShiny. The problem with these libraries, I have written the pros and cons for these libraries. The bouquet is actually interesting when you have high streaming data. So suppose if you have a high streaming data which is flowing maybe per minute or per second, then it would be very useful. The problem with bouquet is that if you have high streaming data, but suppose if you are plotting a couple of variables, then if you are changing values for maybe three or four variables, then it would not work that well. So that is the major issue with the bouquet. And it doesn't have the direct mapping. So whenever you have a data frame, so you don't have to put it in the JSON format. Whenever you have to do the plotting and everything, you don't have to put it in the JSON format. But in bouquet, you have to give it in the JSON format only. So that is the major challenge with this. Then we also have the dash as well. So dash, again, because dash is actually created by Plotly only, so Plotly library. So problem with dash is like it doesn't work with all of the charting libraries. Maybe it would not work well with the matplotlib. And it may not work with the seaborn. So those are the sort of challenges with these libraries. Then again, we have the panel. Panel is again based on dash only, bouquet only. And the good thing about panel is that it has its own internal structure. That is good and bad. Because if you want to change your structure, maybe you do not want to go with the default layout, then there is a problem with that, right? Then in that case, panel would not work well. On the other hand, if you want to host your Jupyter notebooks or maybe Japlin notebooks, then it would work well. Even for, this is true for Bouquet as well, where you can use your Japlin and your Jupyter notebooks directly. RShiny is definitely a good, whenever I have asked people, they have kind of good experience with RShiny because it works well. You don't have to use multiple, you do have to use other language, like CSS. If you suppose in your Shiny app, if you want to use maybe, if you want to give some template, that this is a template I want, that first, this is the menu, that this would be the top header, and under that there would be five or six subheaders as well. In that case, you have to provide one template, that template needs to be in CSS style. So that is the challenge that we face in our Shiny apps. Okay. The second problem is that it doesn't provide unlimited user. Okay. So suppose if you want to host this particular app, maybe on your website, then what do you want? You want all the users to experience this particular thing. But what it does is, first thing is, it only allows five users at a time. The second thing is, it would not allow maybe 25 active hours. 25 active hours as in like within a day, but suppose there are five users who are using this particular app, then what would happen if suppose there is one user who is using this app for 5 hours and he's active on it, then it would not allow more than five users. In that case, and if that particular user is using maybe for 10 hours, then it would not allow more than 3 users or 2 users. So that is the problem with RShiny. Then we needed something which is open source, where people can actually put new features into it if they want to, and create it as easily as possible. So it should be embedded in Python only, and it should be having, you know, whatever requirements are there, they should be encoded easily in that. So I would give you one simple example. So this is like very basic chart that I plotted. So basically, on the left-hand side, you have the code for this. And on the right-hand side, I've given the output. So in Plotly, we all know that it is like very interesting chart. You can interact with that particular plot. You can look at the value of that particular, what is happening maybe in April 2017. You can look at that particular value. You can zoom that particular plot. You can, so those sort of functionalities, they might not be interesting for us, but whenever we have to give these things to our stakeholders. So they need to look at those values, that what is the exact value that I'm getting over here. So this is kind of interesting from one point of view. Okay, so I would not take too much time. So today I'll give you one demo. So general optimization problem, what do we have? We have one objective function. We have certain constraint that I want to keep these particular variables in this particular range. And again, objective function could be maximized or minimized given whatever is the objective. And then on each variable, you tend to have the bound that I do not want this particular variable to go beyond is like maybe 0.3 to 0.5. I do not want this particular variable to go beyond that. So that is the bound that we have to provide on the variables. Given all these things, you need to optimize your function. So what do you have to, you have certain data, you would use that particular data and try to identify weights for that particular particular values, or maybe in this case, so your decision variables are x1 to xn, you need to identify values of these decision variables. And given all these bounds and constraints. So what can we do? In our case, user can provide the input for, suppose if they want to modify the objective function, then what they have to do? So you can actually provide the, maybe you can provide two or three formulas for that particular user that they can actually, along with this base objective function, they can add on to the objective function. So in that case, there would be a maybe bigger objective function, but they can actually customize it based on their need. That I want to optimize the new function rather than the old one. Then similarly, you can also ask for the bounds as well, for what should they bound for that particular weight parameter. And then again, based on that, you can also ask for the constraint as well. So again, I would give you the, okay. So this is how a Streamlit looks. So on the left-hand side, you have, maybe user can select the formula family where there is a formula family A, formula family B, formula family C. Then again, you can provide the structure of the formula. Then this is the formula family, I want to use the formula family A. And in the formula family A, suppose if you want to provide the weights, so this is the first, these first and second formula family A and B, we are just visualizing that what is the last value or what is the output that we are getting and what is the actual values that we are getting. So there is some actual value and there are some optimized values that we are getting. So this is basic comparison of those two plots. So you can actually look at this. You can actually hover this particular plot and look at the values. So on the left-hand side, user can provide the inputs, whatever inputs he wants to use. And on the right-hand side, he can look at the outputs as well. So there are three formulas. One formula is basically, in the formula one, again, we are giving the option like whether you want to use the formula A1 or whether you want to use the formula A2. And based on that, you can provide the weight for that particular formula. And in W2, in this case, would be 1 minus W1, obviously. Not obviously, but yeah. That would be the case. So in the formula two, and again, this is the second formula that we are using, and similarly, we have the third formula. So again, one interesting thing is, you can actually, whenever you have to write the text, you can actually keep your text as a variable as well. So suppose if your user selects the formula A2, then here, where it was A1 earlier, now it shows A2. So you can actually put the text in such a way so that user can know what sort of inputs they are providing. So this is the plotting part. Then we have the third. This is the third formula that I wanted to show. So, and one interesting thing is whenever there is a change in the value in any of the widget, what it would do, it would read the entire script and run it from the start. So it would optimize those values from the start only. So in this case, what user can do is, suppose there are two options that we are providing. One is this real market data, and second is the simulated market data. So simulated market data is, suppose there is a variable X, and which is actually, maybe you found out that this variable X would be varying in this range, maybe from plus 50 to minus 50. Then what you can do, you can actually sample it from a uniform distribution and use those particular values to optimize that your formulas. So this is the kind of thing that you can, your user can do in a Streamlit. So maybe if he selects the real market data, then what will happen? It will show the options that when you want to select the user market data, you want to optimize for the complete period, or whether you just want to look at the last month, whether you want to look at the last 3 months, whether you want to look at the last 6 months. So user can select one particular value. Maybe I just want to optimize this particular formula for the last 3 months. So these are the options that you can get here. And again, you can select the formulas as well, which formula you want to use. And again, then further the different formula. I have removed all the text because it was confidential, so I had to rewrite the script again. So that's why you have a lot of functions like Y1, Y2, so earlier it was not there. So the last thing is that in your optimizer, you can actually provide how many iterations you want to run. Because what will happen if by default, if you're running maybe 500 iterations, then what would happen? It would take a lot of time. And you don't want that for your users, that they are trying to optimize some weights and it is taking maybe half an hour and they went for the tea and after that they are getting the result. That should not be the case, right? So you are providing this input as well, where user can select the number of iterations as well. So once you have selected all the options, so here you can, you are getting the option whether you want to optimize your objective function or not. So there you can select the value, yes, that I want to optimize my objective function. Then further, it runs the script. So in the backend, I'm running the Bayesian optimization here, and where I'm using the tree parsing algorithm to find the optimal weights. Then it shows that for the formula one, you are getting the weight of for W1, you are getting the weight of 0.88. In formula 2, you are getting the weight of 0.6 and 0.3. And similarly, based on that, I'm calculating that what is the objective function was there and what is the, based on the formula 1, how much rupees or dollars you are saving. And that can be seen here as well, that over time, these are the weights that we are getting, that over time weights are being reduced. And at 0.88, that you are having the maximum benefit. So user can directly see here. Then further, you can actually ask your user whether they want to visualize the movement of the market. So basically what we have done is, we have identified some optimal weights. Based on that optimal weight, you would calculate your objective again, what is the value that you are getting, and you can again visualize that how market was behaving and how your new optimized formulas are behaving. So that sort of thing, you can see that from here, when you select this particular weight, then this is the line that you are getting. Or maybe you can ask your user to select maybe different weight. So maybe he selects 0.81. Then you would be, again, it would be looking at the complete script, again rerunning it, and then providing you the results. So this is how you can actually give one interface to your users and maybe your stakeholders, and they can play with it themselves, rather than, you know, waiting for you to, every time they have to optimize something, or they have come up with a new formula, or new negotiation is happening, or maybe some market conditions have changed. So in that case, they can do it themselves rather than relying on you every time. So this is the one part. And in the second part, as I said, that you can also select the maybe simulated market, where you can actually select that my Y1 would be varying plus and minus 50. And suppose you are buying some raw material, and that raw material may be dependent on the oil prices. Then if the oil prices are going down, then you know that your raw material prices would also go down in this particular period. Then what you can do is, you can actually provide that bound that this would go down maybe $50 or plus minus $50. In that case, what will happen? you can pick the values. Obviously, you have lots of distributions. You can choose the distribution based on the understanding of the business, that what sort of distribution should I employ here. But from there, once you have selected that I want to use the simulated market, and this is, you know, I'm assuming that the value could fall in between anywhere in this particular range. So in that case, you could simply use uniform distribution, that it is uniformly distributed over this range. So here we have this particular thing. So what is, like, so there is one thing is, in time series, we all understand the recent period always impact your current values, right? So again, you can give your user an option whether they want to optimize, maybe they want to take the average of maybe 3 months, or they want to take the average of last 6 months. And on top of that, how much volatility is there? So you can provide those options for your user as well. So for each variable. So this is what we have done in this case, where user can again select this particular. One interesting thing is, user can also select the custom time period. So once you will have the custom time period, it would produce a calendar where your user can select that from this period to this period, I want to maybe take the average of this particular value, and on top of that, I want to apply the volatility on myself. So this is also an option here. Then further, similarly, you have the second as well. And suppose your user says that, I want to look at the distribution. What sort of distribution is, these are the sample values that we are sampling from the uniform distribution. And suppose your user just want to, maybe, he just want to look at the distribution. What sort of distribution that I'm getting? So this is the distribution for Y1 values, which is being sampled from this range, 880 to 980. And we are actually looking at the uniform distribution here. So this is how it is. This is the use case that we, for this particular Streamlit module that we have done. And next definitely is conclusion. So in Streamlit was launched in, I guess, April 2019. It's not very old. And in 1 year, we have around like 18,000 stars for that particular module. So it is definitely growing over time. And there are other options for this, for to create maybe notebook or to create apps. You have other options, maybe Bokeh or Panel or maybe Dash you can use. But the problem is, again, as I've shown in the cons as well, every module has some cons. In a Streamlit, because it is open source, you can customize it based on your need, then it really helps in that case. So plus, it runs the whole script. So I have written a couple of points here that it does not allow confusing out of the order execution. It's not like it would just execute this particular portion. The moment you will change the value, it will run the entire script. And in that case, what would happen? Suppose something is going wrong and this with this particular chunk of the code, then you can look at that particular state as well, that what is happening with this particular chunk. Then what I want in the Streamlit, or maybe, who knows, I might work for these, because it is open source, you can do whatever you want, you can add one branch if you want. So one thing is, one weird thing I guess they should have thought, was like, how can I get the coordinates of this particular page? So suppose if I having visit over here, rather than here, I want my visit over here. Then in that case, the whole, there should be some coordinates to reach that particular point. So that user can actually put that particular widget in that place rather than getting the default placement. So that is the one problem that I have faced in the Streamlit. And the second thing, obviously, the only thing other modules are providing is, apart from definitely the best things that the Streamlit is providing is, so there are a couple of other things. One is, it should allow Jupyter notebooks to run in the Streamlit module, and maybe Japlin books as well. And that would solve everything. That would solve, like, you have reduced your 3 weeks time to just 1 week, or maybe if you are really good at it, maybe 2 days. And you can actually create one user interface and send it to your stakeholders. Rather than, you know, keeping them wait for three weeks to get the results, you can actually do this task within 1 day or 2 days. So this is what I have today. So I hope you guys liked it. Do you guys have any question? Okay. Do check out this page. It's really interesting. If you're interested in deep learning, maybe if you want to do the annotation in your video, it would actually give you the bounding boxes from which area you want to do, maybe that this particular section is not coming, then you can actually set the thresholds again, and it could do the annotation based on that. So, yeah. Yes. We have added one layer of authentication as well. You can use the authentication, or maybe, you know, provide the username password to your stakeholders. And because I have not shown the complete data here because it is confidential in our case as well. So in our case, we have the user authentication. So that is also one of the interesting things.